this third lecture of this four-part series on tensor network states, we review the idea of symmetry, and we cast these ideas of symmetry into the language of tensor network states. We talk about such things as the Clifford group of quantum circuits, but we cast it into a theory of tensors, and we unite it with the concept of Penrose duality, and we build several examples and several results based on this notion. This lecture concludes by talking about invariants and covariants of symmetric tensors. As always, thanks for watching, and feel free to let me know what you think. Okay, just a quick reminder of what we've already covered. So this is lecture 3 of 4. Go back to lecture 1 at the very beginning, and we talked about tensors in the graphical language of Penrose. And we could have a tensor or we could have a state. Okay, so this is a state with one index, so you'll call that a valence 1, 0 tensor. So we could also have a tensor here, label this i, j, k. Now this tensor have one index up, two down. This is a valence 1, 2. This could be a tensor psi with one down, and this is a valence 0, 1. And you can start to contract tensors and form networks in the evident way. And we discussed this for some length of time, and we also introduce cups and caps, which are equivalent to raising and lowering indices. So I can take a tensor and I can bend a wire around. And this gives me a way to do that. And then we also talked about the braiding map, or the permutation map. Okay, and this relationship here means that there's a natural relationship, it's invertible. So you actually define, using these two things, an equivalency class, which are all the different ways to reshape a tensor. Okay, we talked a little bit about that. And we went on, and we mentioned several things regarding the factorization of states into tensor networks. And one of the things that we introduced was the diagrammatic SVD. So we take a state, psi, and we say that it's equal to where the center tensor, this one, and now I'm drawing things this way, where the center tensor is just the copy tensor. So it'll take a vector and send it to a pair of vectors, and it works over a complete given basis. Okay, and in this case, for qubits, this could be 0, 1. And from that, we did a bunch of contractions, and we got back exactly what we expected to get back for many different things, including entanglement invariants. So that was kind of the point of the first lecture. And specifically, using these cups and caps, we also showed that there's a relationship where we could take a sigma x operator, and we could think about bending a wire, and now this becomes the state. We also talked about matrix products factorizations, which is an iterative method to factor a state into a 1D structure. And we went on to define a Slock invariant, which was K1, which for a pure state is given by, if I have a state, psi ij, okay, it's just K1 was found to be equal to 2 times the determinant of the coefficient matrix. And that will determine if your state's entangled or not. And from there, we drove several results and then proceeded on to lecture 2. Now, this is the last lecture. In the last lecture, the main point of it was to introduce kind of the backbone of what holds tensor networks together. And to do that, we introduced what are called Boolean tensor networks. Okay, and these effectively glue everything together, and this allows you to sort of combine larger and larger tensor networks in a very controlled manner, because Boolean algebra is something that people have developed reasoning methods for and powerful tools to cope with. And what we did was we said that this is the class of Boolean quantum states, and we called it this. We wrote them this way. Okay, and this X is a sum over all in n long bit strings, so we wrote it this way. Now, another way to write this, okay, graphically, we could have a tensor network which realizes F, okay, and it has an output, okay? So inside of here is a gate sequence to realize that function F. And what we do is we take and we put a 1 up here, okay? And this gives you a tensor network to represent that state. Precisely. So the composition of functions turns into the contraction of indices when you switch from Boolean functions over to tensor networks. And we explored several consequences of that. In addition to the Boolean functions, we talked a little bit about multilinear forms, which are generalizations or pseudo Boolean forms, if you will. These are generalizations of Boolean functions. And these forms have the property that you're going to define a map, F, which goes from the Boolean numbers, okay, but then it can go to C or R. Okay? And you'll notice that you can use these. They're very descriptive, and they also have very clear structure. So an example of one of these was given, and you know, for the GHZ state, this would be written as 1x1 minus x2 minus x1 x2 minus x3 plus x1 x3 plus x2 x3. Now this is actually expanded into the normal form. So if you expand everything in a specific way, you get one unique pseudo Boolean form for every function. And so this one could represent GHZ, and we did some different things with that. And we went on to talk about, well, how do you write down the function for a W state? So if I have a W state, which is equal to 0, 0, 1, plus 0, 1, 0, plus 1, 0, 0, okay, so the prescription is, and I'm going to repeat this even though I've already done it, so hopefully this will be review for everyone, but the prescription is I'm going to make a function that outputs 1 on all of the chosen basis vectors, okay? So the states in the Boolean class have coefficients which take binary values 0 or 1. So my function is going to be defined like this. F of 0, 0, 1 is going to equal F of 0, 1, 0 is going to equal F of 1, 0, 0, and that's going to equal 1. Okay, and else, we're going to go to 0, okay? So the simplest way to do this is to use a sum of products expansion. And the sum of products expansion, in this case, is just going to mean first that I'm going to assign three Boolean variables. Call them x, y, and z. Okay, and in the first case, we want it to be true when you have not x, not y, and z. Or for this one, x naught, y, z naught, or sometimes or is written as a plus or a v. I almost wrote it as a plus there, but either is fine. X, y bar, z bar. Now this is going to be f of w, okay? And that's it. That's the whole gist of it. And then you can write your state by expanding in the fashion that we already mentioned. Now, interestingly enough, the temporal ordering of circuits that is enforced by classical circuits that you actually would build is not enforced by tensor networks. So you can actually build tensor networks where a network such as this, okay, for the W state, this is going to look like, here with an OR. You're going to have some ANDs here. Okay, those ANDs are for these. Down here I'll have some copy, and it'll be copied to every location. Okay, so this circuit's how it's ordered in a sequence where you could have a time steps where you can go through this circuit. Now you also, in tensor networks, you can contract networks, and you can obviously flip the gates in any way you like. So it turned out, and we showed this last time, that this tensor network was another way to realize this exact same thing. So these are equivalent in the tensor network language. So contracting one will give you the same thing as contracting the other. And little is known about the complexity of contracting and synthesizing circuits where you put one gate in one way and put other gates in the other way. And those are atemporal circuits, if you will. And we identified several problems related to that. And I guess people that have done the homework, which several of you have, which is good, because there is beer going around for that sort of thing, you would have already seen that you took that further and you probably got a very good idea of how all this stuff is going to work. Now, on to today's lecture. So really a goal of the course, I think, if everybody could have a bit of a working understanding, so we only have 2 weeks, 4 lectures, a lot of material, but if everybody could go away with a working understanding of the notation and just some properties, then I think it's very successful. And I think everybody's going to do that. So in today's lecture, we're just going to start off by talking about basic properties of symmetries. And we start off now, we use triangles for states, as did Penrose, actually. And we're talking about being a little bit stricter sometimes, where if we keep a wire going one way or the other way, we talk about valence. So the valence here would be 0 going this way, 3 going that way. So you could say that the tensor is valence 0, 3. And we're going to talk about exchange or index symmetry. Okay, so we say that a tensor is symmetric in its legs or arms if you can interchange them without altering the tensor. An example of that. Okay, so if this tensor was symmetric, I could in principle braid it in this fashion, and it would go back to itself. Now, we also have a notion of fully symmetric tensor. A fully symmetric tensor is invariant in this way, but it's also invariant under arm and leg exchange. Actually, if I take this one and I bend this one this way, on this tensor it just goes back to itself. So the copy tensor is completely symmetric, it's fully symmetric. And as we have mentioned, the operation of braiding has a diagrammatic form, which is wire exchange. And you can generate operators that will act as a symmetry group on your space. So for 2 elements, you end up with that. And moving on for 3 elements, you'll also get identity, and you need to have cycles, etc. You get 6 of them. Okay, so returning to this tensor, we say that this tensor is index symmetric, provided we can exchange any of the indices and it maps back to itself. Okay, and now an interesting point, which is possibly quite evident, is if I have 2 tensors which are symmetric and I contract them, the resulting tensor is not necessarily symmetric. Okay, so that's one way to break tensors, is by taking and combining 2 symmetric things. You break the symmetry of tensors, excuse me, by taking 2 symmetric things and combining them. So an example might be if I have a tensor here, which is symmetric, and I have a tensor here, which is also symmetric, okay? If I contract across those indices, then this is possible, quite possible, that it will no longer be symmetric. Okay, so you can also use a symmetrizer. and you can symmetrize a tensor over a group. So if I were to pick a group G, okay, I can define an operator, which is RG, which acts on tensors. Okay, so let's call my tensor gamma. And it takes gamma to 1 over the order of G, which is a scale factor, for all the G in G. And it's going to act on this with some kind of operation on gamma. Okay, and you'll see now that gamma will necessarily be symmetric under that group. Now, everything is not, I'm not putting in types here. So you have to kind of work it out, because if I did put in types, then it gets very ugly to write equations like that. So you introduce curly brackets or maybe dollar signs or something else and say it's a super operator. But I can give an example of it. Okay, so a simple example would be if I take a tensor, okay, and if I want to symmetrize over those two indices, okay, I could write it like this, and in that case, I would have ijk plus, now rg, you'll notice, would do the same thing, except it's going to be 1 over the order of the symmetric group on two elements, so it's just 1 half in front of each of it. So if I were to erase those and put an rg here, and g is s2, now, if you try to symmetrize something that's anti-symmetric, it could vanish. And I have an example of that, but it's quite obvious. So if I were to take a tensor, which is equal to the negative, when I flip the indices, then clearly, if I let RG act on this, then it's going to go to zero. Okay, so apart from braiding wires, I could symmetrize over other groups. Okay, so I could pick, just for an example, I could pick the copy tensor. I'll draw it like this. Okay, and I'm going to pick a group now, G, which is going to be equal to this. It's going to be H cross H, and then the identity. And here H is the Hadamard rotation. Now, if I let RG act on this tensor, now it's going to equal 1 half times the identity map times that, and this will be equal to 1 half copy, which goes back to itself, and you could define a new tensor now if you wished, okay, which is some tensor, and it would still have the three indices, but the internal structure would be given by a sum of two other tensors, which are now necessarily symmetric over that group. So it carries a symmetry now. We also could anti-symmetrize tensors by using an anti-symmetrizer. And the simplest way to do that is by introducing this operator A, which is 1 over n factorial, and it's a summation over g in Sn, negative 1 times pi g. Okay, what does this mean? Well, when pi is equal to 1, g is even, or pi is equal to 0 when g is even, and pi is equal to 1 when g is odd. Now clearly, you also could anti-symmetrize a tensor and you could get something that was zero. So an example would be if you try to look for the anti-symmetric tensor of 3 qubits, you can't find one, there isn't one. There's not a fully anti-symmetric tensor. You could also force an anti-symmetrization over other groups. I'll show one example of that because it's interesting. It's not too relevant past this example, but it's interesting for the concept. So, if I defined a tensor T, I, J, K, which is equal to the copy minus the XOR tensor, and from here on I'll just use that to mean the Hadamard transform a copy, you'll see that if I pick the same group as before, this H identity, okay, what it's going to do is when this acts on it, this one's going to go to that one, and this one's going to go to that one, which will be negative 1, what it started with. So then that one carries an anti-symmetric. This one's anti-symmetric with respect to that group's action. So you could also do that. Now, we're going to go on, and we're going to connect some of these pieces. So this is standard symmetry. So most of you have seen this in one form or another, maybe not with the graphical language and maybe not with this notation. So in principle, what I just said is maybe it didn't look as beautiful as this. But what we're going to do is we're going to see some other symmetries today and probably Thursday that are maybe a little bit more subtle than this. And we'll go back and we'll define, we'll just review it. Now, our state here is delta I, J, K. And we could write this using standard quantum physics notation. Okay, now an upper index and the lower indices usually mean either a bra or a cat, depends on which way your convention is. So let's just say that we have it this way. Okay, as long as you're consistent, that's fine. It's just a matter of you can draw them down, you can draw them up this way. I haven't seen too many people actually draw to the left, but usually it's down or to the right. And so what I do is I'll draw down or to the right, depending on how easy it is to draw it and how much space I have. But I'm known to change, as all of you probably are as well. And we notice that contractions of these tensors, the only thing that's possible is GHZ states. Okay, so these tensors are not that interesting in terms of many-body entanglement outside of the GHZ class. They're sufficient to describe the GHZ class, though, up to local unitary rotations. And we went through, and I'll just remind you of some of the rules, because they're going to start to be important as we start to rotate things, as we start to change the basis of these. So we know that the copy tensor has copy points, so it'll copy that point if it's a copy point. It has a pruning element, which in this case is this plus. It just takes one leg away. You could also let that act on the output. If you copy something, then you merge it, it's the same as doing nothing. And these were worked out in the mid-90s by LaFont, so he studied these tensors in some detail, and the contribution that we made was to basically use those for the SVD and a couple of other things with tensor networks, but the algebra behind this was worked out some time ago. Now, what we'll do is we'll define a operation that will, given a unitary, this operation will take a tensor and it'll rotate that tensor, okay? So let's call it UG, okay? So UG is going to take some tensor, say, and then the question is, okay, so this is our operation. This is how we're going to rotate tensors, and you can rotate them back, you can change your basis. So given some U, you can rotate. Now, we're going to rotate the copy tensor, right? That's a natural place to start, just to study the features of rotation. And here UG would just take the copy tensor, and it would transform it to a new basis. So U and we'll call that basis B in this way. Okay, so the question is, how do we, if I have a basis that I want to copy, how do I rotate from this copy tensor into that basis? Well, you can pick specific U's that will do that for you necessarily. So if I were to want B to copy, say psi to psi psi and psi perp to psi perp psi perp, okay, I could define some basis operation which is necessarily unitary like that, okay, and that will do the job for me. And if you remember from the homework, there's important cases. Well, we talked about in the homework how you could have a unitary, could be 1 minus 2p. P is a projector. Okay, and this creates a bijection between unitaries such that U dagger equals U and projectors where P squared equals P. Okay, so if we want to do rotations where the dagger doesn't matter, then you can use this, and you can notice actually that Hadamard is one of those rotations. So the rotation between the copy dot and the black dot are of that form precisely. Now, an arbitrary rotation, we're going to go back to, okay, so say we've rotated our tensor, we've rotated our copy tensor. Now, to rotate the copy points is a different thing. So here's my new tensor, B. Okay, now I want to have this basis element, and I want it to satisfy this equation. Okay, in this case, then, this B is going to equal X U dagger, okay, and then the B tensor so everybody can take a look at that. Thank you. And so you can see how that works. And likewise for the unit. This is how everything transforms to keep your diagrammatic laws intact. Now, we're kind of building everything up again, and I'm going through it in quite slow and quite painful detail, so hopefully nobody's not falling asleep. So if you are, kind of wake up. It'll get a little bit more exciting now because we kind of set everything up. So the interaction of the network is where it gets interesting. So you start plugging things together. That's when tensor networks, that's when the rubber meets the road, so to speak. Before we get started doing that, we'll talk about De Morgan's law from classical logic. Okay, so De Morgan's law all that is. And that's just a way to relate and or by using the inverter. And we'll note that the inverter, which is X, that equals 1. And likewise, for the relation between copy and XOR, we have a law of the same diagrammatic form, but this time we'll use H. Just to recall, when we use constraint equations, now I equals J equals K, this goes to 1, and else 0, for this tensor. Okay, so now we can make a truth table of sorts for this, and I'll do that just for completeness. Okay, I'm going to stop drawing the kets, but that'll get the idea across. Okay, so this isn't a real truth table. What this means is I'm taking and I'm contracting. Okay, so I would put a 0 there, there, and there. Okay? What does a tensor contract to? Well, the delta tensor contracts to 1, this one contracts to 0, this thing is all zeros down to here, and this one will give you 1 on very specific values. And otherwise it's 0. Okay, so that's kind of a contraction table. Now, my question that I have for you is contraction in this sense linear? So if I had the if I had that table and I tried to contract with some other states, could I figure it out based on having those states in that table? Is it linear? I have the table a little bit confused. Yeah. Okay, so I equals J XOR K, and from that I can go I, which should in principle be equivalent. Yeah, then this is going to be 0, and this will be 0, and that will be 1, etc. So the table's off. Good, no, good catch on that. Very good. Yes, very good. Now, using the XOR and copy, I can always generate, so the table is actually, the table's correct in the notes, I think, so it should be, it's inverted, but, okay, so the table in the notes should be okay, but in any case, so using the copy and the XOR tensors, I can create all the linear circuits, okay, so those are circuits only comprised of those two gates, and those circuits, as we talked about before, have C1, X1, XOR C2, X2, XOR. And this is a very strong normal form on those functions. And you'll see that that normal form is actually could be a consequence of the diagrammatic laws for how these things operate. Now, the key to this is actually given in Figure 2, which was originally done by Lafont, and then reproduced here in our notation. So Figure 2 in the notes goes through and shows associativity, unit laws, symmetry, bialgebra, copy point, Hopf law, and the fact that the unit of the copy point of the copy tensor and the copy point of the XOR tensor go to a scalar. And I won't reproduce those in the board due to time considerations, but I will talk about the class of linear quantum states. So there's some examples. So those are some examples of this type of state. Now you can see that each one of these would have a diagrammatic factorization back into these building blocks we talked about. So this one here would look like this. Okay, this is just that, and this is just a Hadamard transformed copy dot. Okay, so, all right, so, just for the record, anyway, we've fixed the contraction table. The notes will be updated, so everything was off by a little bit there, but it's corrected. Now we're going to carry on and just talk about the circuit model a little bit, and show some cases about how tensor networks and circuits are really the same thing. Okay, except tensor networks are better for various reasons. So circuits are actually a subclass of tensor networks when you have a very strong restriction on the types of tensors and their ordering. Now, everybody's familiar with this from their basic quantum computing courses. And we're going to contract that tensor. And you'll see that this actually is going to be equal to that. So you can interchange these. So if we're doing some tensor manipulations and you want to turn it into a circuit, in many cases using this going backwards, you can. Another example, which is going to be more relevant when we start talking about stabilizer states. Okay, so first thing first, I go backwards with that. It turns into a plus unit for that dot, right? Okay, unit for that, unit for that. So this is going to equal everybody see that? So also, yes, good point. And also in the notes, there's actually more steps than this. So you can go through each little bit. Now, what if I were to start back? Start back with this. Okay, so here I am, and I take this tensor. All right, I contract. Okay, what do I have? Well, I have the copy. This could go to the copy tensor, or I could take this bit here, and I could replace it plus okay, an example back to the circuit model. We could have this circuit, which is a controlled Z rotation. It's well known that I could write this. Okay, using my De Morgan's law, this now becomes equivalent to this. Okay, in terms of a tensor contraction, those are all the same. Now, I can take this, right, by De Morgan's law, and I can pull it through this thing and flip the color here. Which just illustrates how various tensor contractions can go between one circuit identity and the other. Now, another constraining relationship between the XOR and the copy tensors is the fact that they form, they satisfy the bialgebra law. And they actually form bialgebras. They're two different conditions, but we'll just talk about the law today. So I'll now draw this wacky configuration. Okay, and then I'll tell you that it's equal to this one. Okay, and so this is called the bialgebra law. And it's kind of like a C-naught gate flipped on its side. And this is from LaFont. And there's a relationship now that shows that if you have swap gates and you can factor those into C naught squared is equal to identity, then you necessarily have a bialgebra law. So what I mean is, if I were to take a swap gate, okay, and it's well known that I can factor this in this way. Now, you also have, which we talked about last time, okay, and therefore, you can show those. You can show that you basically, you recover something identical to the biogebra law just for circuits. Now, using that law, you can do strange things like pull gates through each other and copy them. So an example would be if I were to draw, the name of this law is called gate copy. So if I were to draw this circuit here, I can take this gate this way, okay, and it's going to copy, it's going to split into two. Okay, now these come apart. You end up with that. Okay, and so that type of identity can be justified by applying the biogebra law. Now, up until recently, we weren't sure what the applications were besides just formally talking about confluence in rewriting systems, and then Sam Denny came along and showed how you can use this and a host of other relationships to solve exactly some 2D topological quantum field theory models. And before that, people have just been doing these analytically, or not analytically. We did it analytically. Sam did it. And I'm helping Sam with that a bit. But he's really leading the show on it. And before that, people were only able to do numerics with these. So we have exact solutions now for a whole class using these types of rewrites. And I used to focus a lot when I taught this kind of course on all the applications. And you see what I do now, it's mostly just about how these things hook together, what's the underlying message, and that's because there is actually so many applications of these that I want to make this as general as possible so that way people can take away from this and use this for just various different things. And the theory is relatively new, so people should be able to apply it to what they're doing and get some kind of insight from that. Something that I won't draw on the board but is in the notes, it just starts with a circuit from Nielsen and Chong, applies a few of these identities, and just kind of minimizes it. And so that's something that'll, it's a good exercise to go through that just to become more familiar with this. Now, the other identity which we've mentioned before is if you contract a copy tensor with a XOR tensor, it results in this. This is called the Hopf law. There's a lot of people in tensor networks that use Hopf algebras, but they don't use the well-developed graphical language, at least not yet anyway. So that's an interesting point. Okay, so now we've really beaten to death the copy and the XOR tensors. And we can start talking a little bit about stabilizers. And you'll see that what we've talked about, well, these are going to be the building blocks of what's to come. Okay, so a unitary map U stabilizes a quantum state psi if and only if this is equal to plus 1 psi. Okay. Okay, so a stabilizer state is defined by n commuting and different operators S formed from the Pauli algebra. These n operators generate the stabilizer group. And so what we mean is we have Pn. We've talked about this before. So the Pauli algebra, and I'm just going to, let's see, how should we write this? Okay, so let's say we have plus or minus 1, plus or minus I. All right, so for sure you have that. And you have identity x, y, and z. Okay, so there's 16 things. You take all n-wise products of them using the tensor product, and that is your Pauli algebra. That is a basis for your operators. There's several different ways to write that. One way would be to present it as a x, y, z generated over tensor, and you also have a multiplication. So what we're going to do is we're going to define operators from this set that stabilize states. And examples of that would include x, which stabilizes plus, okay, negative x, which stabilizes minus, and so on and so forth. And in the notes, we go through definition 42, which should be quite interesting. It basically groups together many different identities with the Pauli matrices. Some of them you might not be familiar with, so have a look at that. It should be pretty good. We don't have time to go through that, and some people might already know most of it, if not all of it, so I'll skim over that. Okay, so an example of a stabilizer state. This could be the Bell state. Okay, what are the stabilizers? What are the stabilizer generators? You could have x, x, and z, z. Okay, so that generates your group. Your full set of stabilizers is identity x, x, z, z, and negative y, y, as you can check from the relation x, y equals I, z. And note that there are n equals 2 generators, and 2 to the 2 equals 4 elements in your stabilizer group. Okay, so just as an example, let's say that I wanted now to find stabilizers of this state. Okay, and I know stabilizers of that state. So what I have here is I have this state, okay, and I know that xx stabilizes this part of it, and I know that z squared is equal to identity, so what I could do is I could make an operator here, say z Does everybody see how that works? So this is now a stabilizer, okay? Because this is a stabilizer. So I act with this one, z squared equals 1. Okay, then I act with two x's, those go back, then I put the z back on. Okay, so in certain situations, there's many different ways to get stabilizers, but in certain situations you can get, if you know a relationship between something and something else, you can get the stabilizers out quite easily. Okay, another example, which I'll leave to you to figure out, would be figure that same thing out for and you remember, this is going to be proportional to the y state. So you have some state, okay, and I want to find stabilizers using this trick for that one, and that's exercise 49, and it's fairly straightforward. Now we'll switch gears a little bit, and we'll talk about a different way to define stabilizer states, and we'll introduce the Clifford group. So the Clifford group. It's a collection of gates. Okay, so that generates the Clifford group. Sigma is any of x, y, and z. The relationship between these is normally given is h, x, h. Of course, h dagger is equal to h is equal to z, and h, z, h is equal to x. And T, or P in this case, so I need to fix that in the notes because I used P in the picture and T in the equations. Okay, so it just shows how these relate. And then you can have a different definition of stabilizer state. Okay, so a stabilizer state is any state that starts off in all zero and is generated using only this set of gates. That's a stabilizer state. Thank you. Okay, so you do, because otherwise how are you gonna turn your C-naught gate upside down? Can you? Oh, you can, can't you? Okay. No, good point. You don't need that, but you do. You don't need that one. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and then there's 3 in here that you. Well, okay. So if you really want a minimal set, I'll give you a very minimal set. That's way more minimal than even what you're thinking in just a second. So Clifford circuits generate the Clifford group, and they stabilize. They stabilize this. They stabilize all the n-letter words formed from that, they'll stabilize it. It means that when you conjugate Pn by any stabilizer circuit that's built out of Clifford operations, it goes back to itself. And from that, and this is kind of explained in a little bit better detail in the notes, we go into stabilizer tensor theory. And in stabilizer tensor theory, you'll see that this, back onto what Chris is saying, so how do you find a nice set of things that generate the stabilizer group? All right, so that set of tensors is sufficient to generate the stabilizer tensors. A subclass of those is the stabilizer circuits that we're familiar with. The proof of that is in the notes. the thing that I would like everybody to think about for just a second is, what does this evaluate to?
Plus.
Yeah, plus, right? Okay, so then if I put a couple of y minuses here, for instance, okay, so this will, you know, those will combine, and that's the same as taking a product of the elements, and then everything contracts, and you end up with a minus. Okay, so it's just notation. And using that, we go through and we prove, we go through that proof, which is good to look at. And there's a couple of different exercises. Now, I'll skip through that because we're running low on time. So the stabilizer of the copy dot. So here's something for you. One of the questions is this. We take the stabilizers of the copy dot, okay, and these are x, 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 negative y, y, x, negative y, x, y, negative x, y, y, z1, well, let's say zi, zj, zi, and those are different, and then identity. Now, here's the copy dot, okay? Let me contract it with another tensor. All right, so this is equal to this, okay? Now, the question that I'm asking is, given the stabilizers of this, which are stabilizers for each of those, what are the conditions on the internal legs, and it's worded in a specific way, such that you can recover the stabilizers of this thing from each of the parts? And so that's one of the questions, which is not too difficult, but it's an interesting question, and it should be kind of fun. Now, stabilizer properties transform exactly how tensors transform. So if I have stabilizers and I rotate my tensor, I rotate my stabilizers, those transform with the same exact operation. So those are the transformation properties. Now, I've casted a homework question which is involving the intersection. So you have the space of Boolean states, you have the space of stabilizer states, and there's some intersection here. And the homework's all about the case when you have two bits. It's not very difficult. It's just a short assignment. It's due on Thursday. And it's just kind of a review of some concepts that we've talked about. Page 17 and 18, it basically goes through the one-bit case and explains enough where you should be able to do that without too much difficulty. And just because I want to mention this, I'll summarize the stabilizer theory. So there's a lot of results that we have basically using tensors to talk about stabilizers. And an interesting one would be also, which relates to the homework, you can write down any so all stabilizer states have that form. So this is sufficient given choices for F, G, and K to express any stabilizer state. And we're going to go back and talk about symmetric states. So symmetric states, you've heard of the Dickey basis or something else. You take and you write down all the symmetric states, and each symmetric state forms a basis. This is well known, the symmetric states for three bits. In this way, GHZ becomes a sum of those two, W is either of those, etc. Now, the space of symmetric tensors and the space of symmetric polynomials are equivalent in dimension, and you can actually set a relationship between them in this fashion. Okay, now I can define creation annihilation operators. I can take the vector space and I can define an inner product on it. For instance, I can calculate the norm between x to the n and itself. So what is the length of x to the n? Well, this is equal to a plus x to the n minus 1. And that is going to equal a minus x to the n minus 1. Equals n times x to the n minus 1. Okay, so These form a basis. You have an inner product on it, and we can equate polynomials and quantum states. Okay, so I can write down so why would we do that? Well, it turns out there's a thing in classical invariant theory called binary forms. Okay, and these are forms which are symmetric. They're symmetric polynomials in two variables, and what they do is they study the part. They study the geometric properties that are invariant under coordinate transformations of these things, and we can use these tools directly now, just with a simple framework, to talk about correlations in symmetric. Symmetric tensors, and we go through this in kind of reasonable detail, reasonable enough to understand it. So the idea would be, I have a binary form, okay, and to second order, I can write a x squared plus 2b xy plus c y squared. This corresponds to a qubit state. Okay, so if I can factor this form, I can factor the state. And people have spent ages, starting with mathematicians like Hilbert, Sylvester, Cayley, trying to understand when you can factor these things for various different powers. And they worked out not only the invariants, so the invariants are maps in the coefficients back to the real numbers, or the complex numbers, depends on how you're doing it. So the real numbers is what we're considering. And the covariants are other, they give other polynomials out. So you have invariants and covariants. And each of them will tell you certain properties about the geometry of your polynomial and hence the properties of your state. Okay? And the example is in the case of three qubits, you have a binary form. And there is the discriminant is the only invariant, which is this thing delta, which I won't write down. And there's a covariant, okay? So the covariant, it transforms with the basis, all right? And that's the Hessian. And this is given by qxx, qyy, minus qxy squared. Now, a binary form Q and XY has vanishing Hessian if and only if Q could be expressed this way. All right, so essentially, what they've been doing in a disguised form is they're studying if you can factor your state. And there's a table made by Sylvester who went up all the way up to degree 12. They say you can't trust the entire table. Nobody's verified all of it, but certain parts have been known to be a little bit astray. But he's basically just trying to get a feel for how many of these there are. He made a table. He counts them. So for instance, degree 6, which is higher than anyone's been able to pull out in the quantum information literature by a couple degrees on symmetric invariants. There are 5 invariants and 26 covariants, okay? And you can go through that a bit in the notes. And this is ongoing work I'm working on with Lin Chin from CQT, who will be joining, actually, IQC, I think, at the end of summer, and also Marco Lanzagorda. And that's where I'll end for today. And if there's any other questions, stick around, and we'll go through homework questions, et cetera. And I'll see you next time. Next time, we're going to talk about the big picture of how this threefold way, how this thing kind of comes together. We'll review a little bit of this stuff. We'll probably start off and talk about some invariants and just talk about quantum network theory and just sort of different ways to factor states into networks. So that's how we'll end it. And see you next time.